not hidden. There's never been a moment you were forgotten. You are not hopeless. Though you have been broken, your innocence stolen. I hear you whisper underneath your breath. I hear your SOS, your SOS. I will send out an army to find.
Veterans Day. Amen. Amen. We get a chance to honor and celebrate our veterans. Is there anybody else in here besides myself that's a veteran? Anybody raise your hand. Anybody in here that's a veteran? Bob, Craig, back there, Gary. I want to, for a couple minutes here, if you guys would just watch this quick video for 2 minutes. Thank you. Would you thank them for their service, our veterans, all of our veterans? I just want to encourage you, even today as you go out to lunch, as you are around tomorrow, you'll see veterans in their uniforms a lot of times. It's a day that a lot of veterans do like to put their uniform back on. It's a proud day for those of us who have served our country. My children asked me growing up, they said, "Dad, what was it like when you joined the military? What was it like when you were in the Air Force?" And I joined at 17 years old. I was underage. My parents, my mom had to sign for me to even join the military. And I was just so grateful for the 4 years that I put in. I joined right at the end of the Vietnam War. And it was obviously not a very popular war. No war is popular, but that one, the vets, the GIs who came home to America did not come home to what you're seeing today. Today we honor our veterans. Today we go up to them in airports and thank them. Years ago when I joined, when vets came home, people went up and spit in their face. And it was just a devastating time. And so I am grateful that today our country finally has come around to realize that when a man or a woman leaves their family for any length of time and serves our country, it's a very honorable thing that they do, and they should be thanked. And they should. So I just want to encourage you, what means a lot to a veteran is just to go up to them and say thank you. Thank you for serving our country. Thank you for going without. Thank you for leaving your families. Don't be afraid to do that today in restaurants or tomorrow, wherever you are. Go out of your way to just go up to the veterans and just say thank you. It just means the world to those, especially who saw active duty, who have lost loved ones. It's hard, and there's a lot of pain that also is associated with days like today, but I would just encourage you just to say thanks. It means a lot to them. So let me pray. Father, we thank you for today. We thank you that we do live in a country that we can still stand and honor our flag. Lord, let us always do that. We are enjoying our freedom today because of the men and women who have sacrificed so much so that we can even assemble together as a church, that we can freely stand and honor our flag and honor our veterans. Lord, I pray today, tomorrow, that you would just bring those people to us that we can just acknowledge their service. And today we ask you, Lord, to just bless this service that we have together, Lord. I thank you for what's already happened here today. Continue to just bless your word to us now, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. I started a series, as you know, at this point, several months ago. Well, not really, but it was several weeks ago, and then fell after and broke my foot after, I think, the second week or the first week. And so we're finishing it up today. I spoke last Sunday, and today I want to finish this series on resolving conflict in our lives. We're all going to have conflict in our lives. It's inevitable. We're human. We're also people who live in this fallen world. And even Christians have conflict with each other. Everybody has conflict. It's part of the human nature that we all have. And so I just want to give you some tools and some things to put in your backpack that you can carry with you. That's what we've tried to do in the first three sermons on this series. And today I would like to close it out with doing the same thing. So I gave you five seeds, but I want to first review. If you weren't here, the first three series sermons on this, everything's online, but let's review real quick. So we looked at, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the sons of God. And I told you there's a huge difference between a peacemaker and a peacekeeper. We want you to be a peacemaker, not a peacekeeper. Blessed are the peacemakers. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. As far as it depends on you. You're not going to change somebody else, but as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. It's important that we make peace. I said when there's unresolved conflict in our lives, we have personal problems that are as a result. It blocks my fellowship with God. It keeps my prayers from being answered. It affects my happiness. If you're in conflict, it'll suck the joy right out of you. It'll just suck the joy right out of you if you're constantly in conflict. And God wants us to have the abundant life. He wants us to have that joyful life. He wants us to be happy. You'll never be happy if you're in constant conflict. And so it's important that you realize there's personal issues here if you decide to be a peacekeeper and just say, oh, it'll go away. It never goes away. First cause of conflict is self-centeredness. Second cause of conflict is pride. Pride only leads to arguments. You show me a prideful person, you show me a person that's always in conflict, and I'll show you a very prideful person. So it's important that we stay humble. So we went over this the first couple of weeks. And those who are peacemakers will plant seeds of peace and reap a harvest of goodness. And so that's what we're going over. There's seven seeds that we wanted to have you plant in your hearts and your minds. We've gone over four. I'm going to go over three today. Seven seeds that we are to plant in our hearts and our minds and our lives if we want to reap a harvest of goodness. First seed was make the first move. Second seed was ask God for wisdom. The third seed was I begin with what's my fault. When you're reconciling, going, moving toward reconciliation in a broken relationship, when there's conflict, you want to restore and renew a broken relationship. First seed was I make the first move. A lot of times we'll sit and we'll wait for them to make the first move. That's not going to happen. It's important that we make the first move. I'm going to run toward conflict. I'm not going to be reactive. I'm not going to be inactive. I'm going to be proactive. I want to move toward the conflict. That's not easy. A lot of people hear that and they go, oh, I hate conflict. Well, everybody hates conflict. Nobody likes conflict. You're sick if you love conflict. Okay, there's something you might want to get to counseling. It's not right if you like conflict. Like drama, you like toxic relationships. None of us like that. And so I just want to encourage you to run toward conflict. Make the first move, and you're not alone. Ask God for wisdom. Ask God for wisdom. You're not alone. He's our helper. He lives inside of us, and he wants to help us. And I begin with what's my fault. There's some part of it that's probably you can take responsibility for. There's some part of it that's probably, maybe you didn't respond right. Maybe you didn't react right. There's some part of it. If you can take any part of it as your responsibility, you go to them and you say, you know, I don't like this angst that's between us. And when you said what you said the other day, I didn't react very well. I didn't respond very well. And I just want to come to you and I want to ask your forgiveness. I want to apologize. I want to take responsibility. And that starts, could we talk about this? Could we go deeper? I really would like to restore our relationship. It's very important. So those are some of the things that are the three seeds. Last week I went over the fourth seed. Listen to their hurt and perspective. In conflict, we think we are argue over ideas, but we really argue over emotions. Somebody got their feelings hurt. Bottom line. And so it's important that we listen for their hurt and their perspective. Really, really listen. Don't go in with your agenda. Listen to where they're hurting. What's their perspective? Because this is true. Whenever people are slighted, not listened to, talked about behind their back, lied to, abused, or robbed of their dignity, they get mad and usually take it out on others. You've heard me say thousands of times around here, hurting people hurt people, but healthy people love people. And it's so important that you realize when people are in broken relationships, somebody's feelings got hurt. And it's important that we acknowledge that. Hurting people hurt people. Why are they lashing out? And so I want you to be able to move toward it, understand that they're hurting, understand there's a lot of emotions at play here. So you go in on your knees, you go in prayed up, you ask God for wisdom, you take responsibility for what part of it you played, and you just say, okay, let me listen. What's going on here? How have they been hurt? How have I hurt them? What have I done? That's all God asks us to do. And I share conflict resolution starts the way you look at the situation. Not looking to your own interest, but each of you to the interest of others. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset of Christ Jesus. Philippians 4:2, 2:4, 5. Not looking to your own interests. If you want to resolve conflict, you have to look at you. You have to look at the three fingers pointing back at you. You can't just point the finger of blame at them. You have to look at the three pointing back at you and say, what part of this? But look to the interest of others. Why are they hurting? Why are they not talking to me? Why are they talking behind my back? Why did they say that about me? Why the silent treatment? Two most immature forms of communication, silence and anger. Why Why are they angry? Why are they not talking to me? Two most immature forms of communication. And so it's important that you recognize what is going on here. What is going on here? So that was the first four seeds. And so today we're going to look at seed number five. You speak the truth tactfully. Speak the truth tactfully. If we're going to make peace in a conflict, we need to speak the truth, but we need to do it in love. We need to do it in love. You've heard people, some people around will say, well, I just tell it like it is. If they're offended, well, that's their problem. And we've all met people like that. That's called being rude, okay? Just bottom line, that's just called being rude. And I wouldn't walk around being too proud of that. Well, I just tell it like it is. Tough on them. Nah, that's not good. That's just pride. That's just pride. And we have to be very careful with that. Remember, if you say something offensively, people usually receive it defensively. If you say something offensively, people usually receive it defensively. A word to parents. The moment you start yelling at your kids, they're not listening to a word you're saying. They're not listening to a word you're saying. And all they're hearing is the emotion, and all they'll remember is the emotion. They're not going to remember your words. So whenever parents come to me, I say, you don't have to raise your voice to raise your kids. You just don't. You just don't. But when you start screaming and yelling and raising your voice, they're going to remember you all right, but they're going to remember the emotion. They're not going to remember a word you said to them, but they're going to remember the emotion behind it. Yelling, guys, in any relationship, yelling never works. You don't have to just be a parent. Yelling never works in any relationship, even as an adult. When you're trying to resolve a conflict, if you're at the yelling stage, stop. Just stop. You just shut off the whole process at that point. Nothing good's going to come out of that. Just walk away. If you got to go take a walk for 5 minutes, 5 miles, do whatever you got to do, okay? Just go for a walk, cool down, simmer off, come back. How can we talk about this? Remember another thing. We're never persuasive whenever we're abrasive. We're never persuasive whenever we're abrasive. People receive truth faster and retain it longer when it's wrapped in love. Bottom line, remember this. Truth without love is resisted, but truth with love is better received. Truth without love is resisted, usually. Turn in your Bibles to the book of Proverbs. The book of Proverbs, please. Book of Proverbs. Get some scriptures here. Speak the truth tactfully. Speak the truth in love. Proverbs 12, verse 18. Reckless words pierce like a sword, but the tongue of the wise brings healing. Reckless words pierce like a sword, but the tongue of the wise brings healing. Look at chapter 13, verse 3. He who guards his lips guards his life, but he who speaks rashly will come to ruin. Let this just sink in. This is God's word. Let this just marinate. This is an act. This is a living book. This is a living document. Living and active and sharper than a two-edged sword. It pierces to the bone and to the marrow. This is God's word to us. And he wants us to really just not read it, but let it read us. You haven't really read a book until a book has read you. And let God's book just resonate with us, change us. That's what it's for. Chapter 15. Verse 1, a gentle answer turns away wrath, but a harsh word stirs up anger. A gentle answer versus a harsh answer. Look at verse 4, chapter 15. The tongue that brings healing is a tree of life, but a deceitful tongue crushes the spirit. Verse 18, a hot-tempered man stirs up dissension, but a patient man calms a quarrel. A patient man, woman, calms a quarrel. Look at chapter 16, verse 23. A wise man's heart guides his mouth, and his lips promote instruction. Pleasant words are a honeycomb, sweet to the soul and healing to the bones. So it's so important. I think we get the point here. God's trying to say, listen, here's my word. Here's what I would like to have you incorporate into your life, my life. Be careful about your tongue. It's set on fire, as James says, by hell. Let's be really, really careful the words that we say to one another. If you want to resolve and reconcile and restore broken relationships in your life, you got to be really, really careful. I have to be really, really careful what I say. And so here's just a few of the scriptures. There's tons of them. I just picked out some that I wanted us to just let us get into us. And just whatever you have to do, if you're having trouble with your tongue, if you get hung by your tongue on a regular basis, you might want to just bring some scriptures into your heart, into your life, put them on the dash of your car, put them on the mirror in your bathroom. Wake up in the morning first thing to say, I got to get this scripture in me, because today I want to be careful because I'm getting hung by my tongue a lot. And I want to be really careful that the words of my mouth are pleasant, like a honeycomb, that they're sweet. And so if you're having trouble with that, the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. It's a heart issue. Okay, the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. So it means something's going on in your heart. If you're having trouble with your tongue, you're having trouble with your heart. And so it's important that you look at both. Ephesians 4:29 says this, do not let any harmful words come out of your mouths, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs. According to their needs. Be really careful of the harmful words that come out of our mouths. We're all guilty of this. I stand right in the front of you and I'm guilty of this. We say harmful words sometimes and we need to just stop and catch ourselves. What's going on? I can't excuse that. That was just wrong. It's just wrong. And it's important that we keep short accounts with God. It's important that we keep short accounts with each other. Stop, drop, pray. Do whatever you got to do. Don't let the sun go down. And again, when you're guilty of that, repent of that and ask forgiveness of that as well. And we're all guilty of that. But let's try to have new habits in our lives. If you're married, it's inevitable that you will have conflict. Just wanted to give you that nugget that some of you have never heard, you know, and just knowing that's a truth that some of you just never realized, especially those of you who are married. But if you're married, okay, it's inevitable that you are going to have conflict, period. You've got two people coming together to try to be one, two very sinful people at times, two people that are just self-centered and selfish at times, coming together to try to be one. How does that work? Sometimes it doesn't work too good. It doesn't work too good. So there's going to be conflict when you have two flawed people trying to be one. It doesn't work. It's another reason that God said, be careful not to be unequally yoked. Unequally yoked. You say, oh, gee, isn't that kind of antique and ancient? No, no, it's in God's word for a reason. Don't be unequally yoked. I have people come to me and ask me to do premarital counseling, which I'm such a huge advocate of, and do months of premarital counseling to help couples get ready for marriage. And they may say, well, you know, I think he's a Christian. Okay. I know after we get married, he's going to change, Gail. I just know he's going to change. Oh, yeah, he'll change. Yeah, you're right. He's actually going to change. But you're not going to like what you see. You know, it's important that you're not unequally yoked. It's important that they love Jesus more than they love you. It's important that they care for the Lord more than that they care for you. I was raised on a farm. My uncle, grandfather took all my summers working on dairy farm in upstate New York where I was raised. And we would have teams. My grandfather had a team of horses. And he would, you know, he used to plow with that years ago before tractors came in. But he kept his horses, and sometimes he would yoke them up. And he'd say, look at Ricky, let me show you what these horses can do when the two of them are together. And there's always kind of a alpha dog in there, but one just pulls the other in this yoke on their backs. And just look at how the power and the strength. They used to have horse pulls where I was from. And so when you have two horses, or you have two oxen together, or two mules together, when you put two of the same together and you yoke them with the Lord, there's nothing you can't do. But when you put an ox together and you put an ass together, guess what? Everybody's fighting, okay, for their position. Because the Bible says be equally yoked. Well, if you put a donkey and you put an ox together, or you put an ox and you put a horse together, they're unequally yoked. And one's going to try to pull this way and one's going to try to pull this way. And this is what happens in marriage when you're unequally yoked and you're not together with the Lord. You don't love Jesus more than you love each other. You're pulling. You're constantly pulling your own way. And it is going to just be horrendous in marriage. Horrendous. So it's important that you're yoked together with somebody who has the same beliefs that you do, especially starting there. It doesn't mean everything's going to be the same, but do they love Jesus more than they love you? If they don't, please flee. Run like a rabbit away from them, okay? Just get out of there, okay? If they aren't the ones getting up on Sunday morning and say, come on, let's go to church. Come on, let's go. Come on, let's pray. Come on, let's read the Bible together. Come on, ladies, if that guy isn't doing that, find another guy. Okay, find another guy. And if he says, you know, I'm sorry, I'm just not there, would you help me? That's a humble man. You know, you were raised in a Christian home, I wasn't. You're further along with Jesus. That's why I wasn't. Mimi and I got married almost 40 years ago. She was way beyond me, okay? I was looking for other things to, you know, be with her about, mainly her body. And so that was where I was at. So it was a point where, though, I loved how she loved Jesus. She turned me on because of not just her looks, and I was attracted to her. She turned me on because of her love for the Lord. It was just like, wow, I want to be like that. She really encouraged me. So ladies, you can encourage your man. If he's not taking the lead, either leave him or help him take the lead, okay? But just help him and say, you know, it's my desire that you would pray before we go out on a date. It's my desire that we would talk about the things of Jesus and the things of the Lord. We're talking about everything else but him. And you can help them. And you'll have to determine, do I stay with him? Because you're either going to have an ox and an ox or an ox and an ass. Okay? Just putting it straight. Just putting it straight. Just make sure you're equally yoked. You're equally yoked, or you are having all kinds of problems in your marriage. Hope I didn't offend you with that. If I did, just send the emails to Ron and stuff. So, there you go. Thank you, Jesus. It's in the Bible. So, when we fight or have conflict, we have to determine, guys, which words that we're going to take off the table in a conflict. You got to determine which words you're going to take off the table in a conflict. Is the divorce word, is the D word constantly brought up in your marriage? Or is that one off the table? What are you going to, are the in-laws, is your father, your mother brought up often in the relationship? If it is, take it off the table. Take it off the table. There is no comparison to your dad or your mom or things like that. Or my mom used to, or my mom, stop. The day you said I do and the day you walked out and I pronounced you husband and wife, that's it. Mama takes second place, okay? Daddy takes second place. They are now in the chain of counsel, but they're no longer in the chain of command. You don't go run home to mama and daddy. It's over, okay? You cut the umbilical cord. It's it. The two became one. Didn't include your mother and father being there in the honeymoon with you. Just the you and her, you and him. Two became one flesh. And that's important that you say now, we're going to work this out. That's why premarital is so important. That's why I do months of premarital counseling. We talk about the in-laws and the outlaws. We talk about all this stuff. It's important that you understand what happened when you say, I do. And that covenant is sealed. And the rings come in and the vows come in. And then the wedding night and the time that you consummate your marriage and all that stuff. It's all part of it. You need to understand all of that. So that when you go into marriage, you're going in with your eyes wide open instead of your eyes half closed, thinking you're going to change him or her. You're not. You're not. So it's so important that you really talk about these things. Instead of when you're going out on a date, if you're dating, you're not talking about fluff. You're not talking about weather talk. You're talking about some really serious stuff. Okay, especially if you're serious, you're talking about everything. You're reading books together. You're not going to Regal. You're not going to, you know, the dollar store theater here. You're going out and you're talking about lots and lots of stuff together. Well, what do you think about this? Well, what do you think about children? And what do you think about disciplining of children? And what do you think about this? And what do you think about, You know, I just wanted to go out and watch a movie. That's what most people want to do. No, get off the weather talk and let's get serious and let's talk. What do you believe? And it's okay if you don't know what you believe, because you got to be careful. People behave what they believe. People behave what they believe. And so you have to find out, what do they believe? What do they believe about? Not just biblical things, but all kinds of things. What do they believe? It doesn't mean you're going to believe in everything together, but know who you're with. Know who you're with. And don't be afraid. Okay, if you're dating, you've already impressed him enough to get him or her. Okay, stop trying to impress. Now it's time to get down to it. Don't worry if they're going to break up with you because all of a sudden you said something. Then good, wave goodbye. See you later. Oh God, I'm so glad you left me now. Goodbye. But you know, it's a point where don't get offended. All that. Oh no, I'm worried he's going to break up with me. Good. If you're worried about that and you've been dating for a few months, you've got more happening than worrying about breaking up. Okay, there's a lot more going on here. And it's in you. It's in you. You are the one that has to determine your standards. You're the one that has to determine, what do I want? He doesn't complete me. I'm not looking to go in as a half person and have somebody complete me. You go in as a whole person. You've done personal counseling. You've reconciled the sins of the past. You've reconciled the angst that you have toward your parents from the mistakes they made raising you. You've worked on past relationships where you lost your virginity or something happened. You've worked through all the stuff in your mind to say, I'm going into this relationship a whole person, not a half a person, hopefully that they will complete me. Don't ever look for someone to complete you. That's not the goal here. You're going in as a whole, healthy, loving person, and that's what you're looking for to be married to the rest of your life. It's the most important decision you will ever make apart from Jesus, is who are you going to marry? It merits so much work. It merits so much just really finding out who you're with. And then just a lot of prayer and fasting. Lord, have you called us together? And I need to fast about this one because I've got to have that peace that passes understanding. I've got to know that I know that I know in my knower that this is the one. This is the one. And when you know in your knower and you have that peace that passes understanding, it's huge, huge. And then you do the work, the hard work of the soul to really get ready. So what words are off the table? You have to determine that. Talking about your previous spouse? Oh, that's always helpful, you know. Stop. You know, we're not going to talk about anything in the past, especially comparing to some previous spouse. That really works all the time. So no. And just determine what you're going to take off the table. What words are volatile and you're going to take off the table. Yesterday was in our country or in the world, celebrated 30 years of the end of the Cold War. Pretty much people conclude that the falling of the Berlin Wall in Germany, that was kind of the end of the Cold War. That was 30 years ago yesterday. Well, during the Cold War between the Communist East, Soviet Union and all her allies, and the Capitalist West, the United States and all of our allies, even during the height of the conflict, both sides agreed that some weapons were off the table. Some weapons were off the table, and we would never use against each other in the height of the Cold War. They called them WMDs, weapons of mass destruction. They said these weapons are off the table. Both countries agreed that we will threaten each other, we will fight, we will argue, and we will disagree. But along with our allies, we will never, never drop the big one. We will never do that. Neither side can drop the atomic bomb. Neither side can use nuclear weapons. If either side decided to do that, life as we know it is over. Life as we know it is over. Because if some other country decides to nuke us, we're going to retaliate with what's left. And then that's going to start this war that none of us even want to think about, because life as we know it is over. Is over. So the countries, when you hear of peace treaties and you hear of nuclear treaties and things like that, they're very serious. Very serious. Even though a lot of times they're broken and stuff, still, we said we've got to have these weapons of mass destruction that we will not use with each other. There's this unwritten awareness between both countries. It was actually called MAD, Mutually Assured Destruction. If we use these weapons, we will have mutually assured destruction. And we cannot We cannot use nukes. We cannot drop these bombs. And even though we hate each other, even though we'd like nothing more than to obliterate each other, we will never use these weapons. That's why these treaties are so important. If certain things were not taken off the table between the countries, we would have mutually assured destruction. Apply that to marriage. Apply that to relationships with friends. Try that to relationships with your aunts and your uncles or extended family, people that you're in conflict with. Apply this to your roommate. What are the weapons, not just the weapons, but what are the words of mass destruction? What are the words of mass destruction that you use with each other? Because if we don't take these words of mass destruction off our table, out of our relationship, it's not going to last. It's not going to work. You will have mutually assured destruction of this relationship if you don't take these WMDs out of the relationship. It's so, so very important. Determine ahead of time, before conflict arises, which harmful words you will never use. You will never use. Determine that. These are some of the things you talk about when you're dating. To say, you know, I'm triggered by this. I had some trauma in my life. Whenever either you say or you do this, I just want you to know it's going to trigger me. I remember one time I was working on my car in Las Vegas. Mimi and I just gotten married. Living in Las Vegas where I was stationed in the military. Got saved in Las Vegas, entered the ministry, and got married all in Sin City. Where sin abounds, grace abounds, much more. And so God was good to me in Las Vegas. Lived there for 12 years. We had been married. We were in a one-bedroom apartment. I'm down working on the car. All of a sudden, we were having some kind of a disagreement. And for some reason, my wife kind of, she didn't do anything. She just slammed the door. It just triggered me in such a way that I was surprised. I'm going, I got infuriated. I'm thinking, she's slamming the door in my face. And it triggered me. I didn't know that I had a spot there that was triggered. And it was like every time I wanted to say something to my parents or every time at home, they would just slam the door in my face. And all of a sudden, first year of marriage, first few months, the door slammed, and all of a sudden this old stuff came up. We should have talked about it. I don't know why we didn't. We had 1 week of premarital counseling. I don't know why we didn't get to the bottom of all this stuff. But anyway, we didn't. And so as a result of that, I was triggered. And there's certain smells that will trigger you. There's certain words that will trigger you. There's certain songs that trigger me. We're all triggered. And it's so important that you know each other's triggers. These are something you could talk about and the next time you go out and you're sitting there having a cup of coffee together. Say, hey, could I ask you a question? This kind of came up in church this morning. Is there anything in your past that triggers you? You know, I don't know, you know? Is there anything in your past that triggers you? Any sounds, any smells? Like sometimes somebody smokes a cigarette around me. I crave smoke. I smoked for years. Started in my home at 14, smoked 2 packs a day. Joined the Air Force, all that. Smoked for several years till the day I was baptized at 25. And I was baptized. And I said, you know, if I'm going to be baptized, I'm going under. I want to come out a new creature. I'm putting this smoking thing behind me. I haven't had a cigarette since the day I was baptized 40 years ago. But to this day, oh, would I enjoy a cigarette? Would I enjoy a cigarette? It just triggers me. The smell of smoke, especially in cold weather or something like that. When I walk somebody and they're smoking, it's like, Rick, walk away. Walk away, walk away, walk away, walk away. You know, because I would enjoy smoke. I enjoyed smoking. That's how dumb that is. But anyway, I enjoyed smoking, even though it was killing me. And stuff. But it's just a point, it triggered. There's certain Neil Diamond songs that just trigger me. Okay, I was in certain places during the, just trigger me. You know, I love Neil Diamond. I grew up on Neil Diamond. And it's confession day. It just triggered me, you know, and stuff. So there's stuff in our lives that just trigger us. And you got to be careful. Good thing to talk about in your next date. You can blame me if you want to. So, all right, number six, fix the problem. Another seed to plant in you so you can be a peacemaker. Number six, fix the problem, not the blame. Fix the problem, not the blame. In other words, attack the issue. Don't attack each other. Attack the issue. Don't attack each other. So important. If you're fixing the blame, you're not fixing the problem. That's all there is to it. If you continue to fix the blame, you're not fixing the problem. How's the word blame spelled? Be lame. Okay? Be lame. Don't be lame. Okay? Don't be lame. Stop fixing the blame and start fixing the problem. Work on the problem. And so it's so important that we understand fixing the blame game is a waste of time. It's just a waste of time. And we just need to stop it. So let me ask you, are you having trouble in your marriage with sex? What about finances? You having trouble with your kids in your marriage? You having trouble in your relationship with getting angry? Maybe being silent? Two most immature forms of communication are anger and silence. Do you have a tendency to go toward one of those? Is that an issue in your life? You're just like, oh, I want to say something, but I can't. Or I'm saying it, and I'm saying it way too loud and proud. Are those issues in your life? What's going on in your life? You having trouble with your work schedule? You having trouble with the porn schedule? You having trouble with all that stuff in your life? That means you have to stop and say, I got to take care of this. I need to make sure that I fix the problem. I just thought it was her problem. I just thought it was his problem. No, it's moi. It's my problem. And I have to take care of it because this isn't working for me. I find that I have a tendency to go toward this or that. It's all unhealthy. I'm not going anywhere in my life if these issues are in my life. And I need to take care of me before I start blaming others. You get a blame game. Well, it's just you, it's you, it's you, and you blame each other for so much. There's three fingers pointing back at me. Stop pointing the finger of blame and look at the three fingers pointing back at you and me. What is going on with me? What's going on in my life? The issue isn't her or him, it's me. I'm the one that did that. I'm the one that thinks that. I'm the one who opened that website. I'm the one who did that. You have to look at you. And at that point, what you have to do is you say, I got to take care of me. I'm unhealthy. I'm going nowhere fast in my life with these addictions and vices. I'm going nowhere fast in my life if I keep doing this and doing the same thing the same way, getting the same results. It's called insanity. Why do I think that that's going to get better? It's not going to get better. I know the porn issue will get better after we're married. It gets worse. It gets worse. It has to be taken care of. I had said one Sunday here, I said, you girls that are dating these guys, one of the things you can talk about when you're out for coffee is say, how are you doing with the porn? The girls come up and say, what? I wonder that all the time, Rick. I actually do wonder that because I know it's a big issue today and in our sexualized society. You mean I can actually ask my boyfriend that? Please. Please do. Please do. Ask him who he's accountable with. Ask him who is speaking into his life. Ask him who asks him the hard questions. Ask him who he's talking to about his eyes. Ask him how he's doing in that area, knowing that he's human. And he probably doesn't want to do it either. But you as a girlfriend, you have every right to say that to him. Ask it to him. Well, I'm afraid you'll break up with me. Goodbye, goodbye, so long. Don't let the door hit you on the way out. You know, let him go. Let him get, if that's a took, if he was so offended by that, he's guilty. Okay, he's doing it. If he gets all defensive, he's already shown you he's guilty. A person who's not doing it or is struggling with it and is doing the best he can with it, he's got help, he's got counsel, he's got accountability, that's who you want to talk to. You know, I had a struggle in my life, and this has been an issue for me. I want you to know I'm seeing so-and-so on a regular basis. I'm in this program called the Conquer Series or True, you know, all the different series that are out there. I've gone to the pastor for help. I'm going to counseling now. That's an honest man. He said, you know something? Thank you for being honest with me. No. Thank you for asking me that really hard question. I tell you, we're at a whole different level here, aren't we? Yes, we are. We're no longer talking about the weather. We're no longer talking about the weather. If I'm going to be with you and you're going to be with me and we think this thing could be going somewhere, I have to have permission to ask you questions. I have to have permission to speak freely. I have to have permission to do the last 10%. We just have to because this could be God that brought us together. And I want to know before we say I do, are your triggers? How's your thought life? How's your relationship with your parents? Do you have any unforgiveness toward your dad? Do you have any unforgiveness toward your mom? Do you have a father wound that you're covering up, you know? Do you have a mother wound that you're covering up? Do you have some angst as you think back to some of the mistakes your parents made? Welcome to life. We all make them. Have you forgiven your mom and dad? All those things are talked about when you're out on a date. It's so, so important. So stop the blame game. Don't be lame. Start fixing your problems. Take a look at you first. And last, as we close up, seed number 7, focus on reconciliation, not resolution. Focus on reconciliation, not resolution. What is reconciliation? Reconciliation means reestablishing the relationship, burying the hatchet, and living at peace. Resolution means we resolve every disagreement and we tie a pretty bow around every argument. Not, okay, that is so unrealistic. That's not going to happen. You're not going to tie a pretty bow around every argument. You're just not. That's not your goal. Your goal is reconciliation. The goal is to forgive. The goal is to learn from the mistakes. The goal is to say, why did this trigger us? The goal is to say, can we be reconciled here? Can we bury the hatchet on this one? Can we move forward? You know, I appreciate you asked me to forgive you, and I believe you were sincere. I forgive you. The only way that you can cancel the debt, because unforgiveness means you owe me something, is forgiveness. Forgiveness brings closure. Nothing else brings closure. I'm sorry, that doesn't bring closure. But to say the words, please forgive me, and to hear back, I forgive you. Canceled! Satan, get out of here. No longer will you affect this area of our life because we have broken this debt. He or she doesn't owe me anything. It's done because I forgave them. And when I said, I forgive you, it's over. We don't bring up past things. We don't bring up the things that were from yesterday. It's over. And that's how important that is. The only way you bring closure is through forgiveness. So work on that forgiveness and cancel the debt. Because unforgiveness means you owe me something. And so it's so important. We're not toward resolution. Oh, every argument's going to be resolved. Everything's going to work out. No, it's not. There's just some things in our marriages and our other relationships you're never going to agree on. Ever. And that's okay. That's okay. There are some things. Please be idealistic, but please be realistic. There's just some things you're never going to agree on. Ever. In marriage, in relationships with your roommate, things like that. There's just not. That's why the very first week I shared the scripture of Romans 12, 18. If it's possible, as far as it depends on you, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Live at peace with everyone. As far, you can't change other people. You can only change you. That's it. You're not responding. You can't change another person. All you can do is work on you. And so as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. As far as it depends on you. Well, I want to change them. You're done. You're not going to change another person if they don't want to be changed. You can influence. You can have a profound impact on their life. But it's ultimately, if they're going to change, it's going to be up to them. It's not because of you. A lot of people get all caught up in that. And say, well, if I'd have just been a better son or daughter, if I'd have been a better wife, if I'd been a better husband, if I'd have been... Stop. 83% of all fifth and sixth graders blame themselves for their parents' divorce. 83% of all fifth and sixth graders blame themselves for their parents' divorce. I was there. I was one of them. If I'd have just been a better boy, if I'd have just been a better son, my dad wouldn't have drank. If I'd have just been a better brother, my dad wouldn't have come home drunk. He would have wanted to be home with us. I blame myself for years for my parents' divorce, my dad's alcoholism. That's just the nature of being emotionally immature. It's the nature of not having conceptual thinking until you're about 11, 12, 13 years old. And then you start going, wait, A plus B does equal C. It's not my fault. And so it's so important that we understand this. You can still disagree without being disagreeable. That's called maturity. You can still disagree without being disagreeable. That's called maturity. I read it here. A wise man's heart guides his mouth, and his lips promote instruction. It's so important that we understand that we can have unity without having uniformity. We can have unity without having uniformity. You can walk hand in hand, but that doesn't mean you see eye to eye. My wife and I walk hand in hand. It'll be almost 40 years that we've been married. Do you think we agree on everything? We are completely different. We are opposites. Just complete opposites in many ways. Obviously, after 40 years, there's a lot of similarities, but we're still pretty opposite. I like jumping out of airplanes, okay? That's not my wife, okay? That's not my wife. She stayed on the ground and prayed for me, and I had like 100 people praying for me that I would just make it safely, you know? So that's just the nature of who we are, and I appreciate that about her. My own counselor told me, said, Rick, you would be dead if it wasn't for your wife. She is your rock. She is the one that has kept you actually grounded a little bit, because I'm not sure you'd be alive as many risks as you take. I'm not sure you'd be alive if it wasn't for your wife. I appreciate my wife's stability that way, but I'm crazy at times, okay? I like living life to the fullest, okay? I hate the word average. I don't like the word norm. Don't ever say those words to me. Be weird, okay? Be weird. It's not a bad thing. It's not a bad thing. If you want to accomplish things in life, you can't play it so close to the chest, okay? You got to take some risk. You got to take, not, don't be stupid. Some things I've done are stupid. This wasn't stupid. This was just an accident. But it could have been. But it's a point where, you know, don't be stupid. But just know that there's opposite. Mimi and I walk hand in hand, but we don't see eye to eye. And a lot of things. That's okay. She balances me out. I balance her out. And our kids suffered because of it. No, I'm just teasing. But anyway. You can have reconciliation without resolution. All right. In closing, guys, let me just say this. As we close out this series, I want to encourage each of you to be agents of change. Be agents of change in this world in which we live in. We live in a world that's full of conflict. Full of conflict. Yeah, I mean, you see it. You see it. It's all around us. There's conflict everywhere. There's conflict in our government, our institutions, our colleges, our workplace, our schools, our neighborhoods, our families. There's even conflict in our churches. And it's wrong. Some of you have come from churches where they were so toxic. There was so much drama. There was so much gossip. There was so much craziness. We made a commitment 14 years ago when we started Mosaic. We just said, we want to have a healthy church. We want to have a church that lives by faith, is known by love, and is a voice of hope. But to be a church that really is known by love, that means there's no gossip. There's no backbiting. There's no sidebar conversations or parking lot conversations. There's none of that. We if we want to have a healthy church, then we've got to be healthy leaders, and we've got to make sure that we honor each other. We've got to make sure that we are working together in a way that isn't just faking it till we make it. It's so important that you understand how that if you're going to have conflict and if you're going to resolve conflict in your life, it's up to you to say, what am I going to do? I'm the pastor of this church. Okay, so with everything rises and falls on leadership, there's certain values that Ron and I and other leaders live by here. We have 10 of them. They're on our website. And it's one thing to have an awesome mission, which we do, Matthew 28, to go into the world, make disciples. It's awesome to have an awesome vision. It's on the wall, live by faith, known by love, voice of hope. But it's another thing to have the values. We have 10 values that we live by. And you can look at what they are. You could have values in your life because it's the values that'll make or break you. It's not the mission or the vision. It's the values that make or break. It's how you live every day. What are our values? It's so important that we love each other enough to hurt each other. We love each other enough to talk about the last 10%. You say, oh, did anybody else see that? Oh, I didn't see that. Anybody else? There's an elephant in the room, okay? Did anybody else see the elephant walk in? No, we're fine. I didn't see any elephant. Did you see an elephant? It's stepping on your air hose. We can't even breathe in here. Yeah, the elephant's in the room. Can we acknowledge it? Oh, a lot of places, no, I won't acknowledge the elephant. You could tell somebody's body language. You're leading a meeting, a small group, and all of a sudden you say something. You could tell by their body language. 80% of communication is nonverbal. You could tell by their body language they're offended. You could tell by their body language, or they may have said, no, I'm okay. Yeah, everything's fine. Come on. What did I just say? I reel back. Did I just say something as the leader of this meeting or the facilitator of this meeting that could have possibly offended them? We acknowledge it. We stop the meeting and say, whoa. I think we're running ahead of something here. It appears to me that you could be offended. It appears to me that I just said something I could tell by your countenance. Are you sure? Oh, we're okay. Come on. You know we have permission to speak freely. Umbrella of mercy here, another value. No stupid question or stupid answer. Let's talk. Let's talk. We can't leave this meeting. I don't want you feeling that way because right away you're telling me you're okay, but you're all crossed up. I'm okay. Everything's fine. Well, unpretzel your body, you know, so that we can. You're looking like you're hiding behind. You know, open up. Oh, tell me. And see, that's a culture that you establish. You have to establish that culture as a church, that we can have permission to speak freely. We will, you know, begin with, you know, you in mind. Seek first to understand before being understood. That's our number one value. It's so important that you have those to run your life by. And so I just want to encourage you, in conflict, have as a value, I'm not going to be a peacekeeper. I'm going to be a peacemaker. I'm going to run toward conflict. I'm not going to run away from it. I'm going to acknowledge when the elephant comes in the room. I'm going to acknowledge that there's little foxes that are trying to destroy my vineyard. I'm going to acknowledge them. Something just came in our relationship here, and I don't want this to hurt our relationship. And so this little fox runs in, as the Bible says, and it wants to steal the fruit of your vineyard. It wants to rob you. Kill the sucker. Okay, just shoot it. You know, cage it or kill it, but don't feed it. A lot of times we feed it. These little foxes, oh, we're okay, it's okay. It'll become a wolf. It'll be breathing down your neck and dripping on the back of your neck. You're like, oh, why is everything so heavy? Because you fed that little fox. You knew that that wasn't good for your relationship. You knew you shouldn't allow that in. You did not have a line in your relationship that says, we will not touch each other's body. You knew that this was going to happen. You let that fox in the door. And once it got a toehold and it came in and got a foothold, that's it walked over your threshold, and now it's got a stronghold. And we got to say, no, we can't do that. We've got to back up and say, we're not even going to let his little toe over the threshold, because I'm going to break his toe. I'm going to slam the door on that, because even though I want to sleep with you, even though I want to have you touch me, even though we have set a standard that said, no, we're never going to let that fox in, because if we let that fox in, it's going to become a wolf. And then we're both going to do something we're going to highly regret. So you have to determine in your life, where is it in your life that you will live? As much as it's up to you, live at peace. Take care of you. Be a healthy you. Be the most healthiest you can be. And then when you go with somebody, you're not talking about the weather anymore, because you're a healthy you. You've dealt with the sins of your past. You canceled the multi-generational transmissions of sins that have been handed down to you from your great-grandfather. You're canceling them. You say, as for me and my house, this is how we're going to live, and we're not going to have any curse over our family. Determine that. Right now in your age, and God will honor it. God will honor it. So Father, I pray for each and every one of us in this room. Help us, Lord, to know that conflict is inevitable. The rest of our lives, we will have conflict. And I pray, Father, for all of us, that we'll take some of these tools, plant these seven seeds in our lives and in our hearts and in our minds, that you would use these seeds, God, and that you would help us to really start turning things around. Because right now, all I know is all I know. And I can only do what I've done. And I've got some stinking thinking and some junk in my trunk. And I want to empty that out. I don't want to live that way. God, I really want to not walk around guilty. I don't want to walk around with shame. I want to resonate with Brené Brown and other people who say, no shame. That's not what you want for us, Jesus. You don't want us to walk around in shame and guilt. And unresolved conflict. You don't want that for us. So God, I pray for each and every one of us in this room that we would move toward conflict, that we would make peace with those that we have a broken or a strained relationship with, that we would be peacemakers. I pray this for all of us in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Love you guys. Please, if you need prayer, come forward, and we'll be happy to pray for you. See you next week. God bless you.
You're the only one I won't cling to. You're the first thought on my mind. Let our voices rise, all creation cries, sing out in endless hallelujah.